All right, we're off and running. Welcome, 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 welcome. And let's all keep our great sense of humor here as we go forward. Actually, the world's going in reverse as we go. The world goes in reverse, and we say, let's rise above all this. Welcome to the video. I'm in pretty good shape today. Let me start out with an analogy on your spiritual path. What's important is the basic stuff. Our goal is abidance, and that which leads to abidance is all important. The other stuff is superficial. There's a lot of superficial spirituality, esotericism, mysticism, all this stuff, metaphysics. That's all superficial, very superficial. Psychic powers, this and that. Forget about that stuff. I use the analogy of golf. It's a great analogy. You see these guys out at the local muni, and they've got a bucket of balls, and they're chipping, and they chip all day, and they putt and they chip, and they putt and they chip, and they work on their short game all day long. Why? Because that's how you get a good score. Okay, you get a good score on your scorecard, because you can do that. This is superficial. This is superficial. I used to do that, a little dabble in that, and think this is the way, and you know, it's not the way. I said, this really isn't it. I want to be able to really actually do it the right way. And it's about ball striking. It's about ball striking. And the spiritual path ultimately is about abidance. Okay, it's not about metaphysics. It's about abidance in the total non-suffering mindset. Totally non-suffering mindset. You see, this world, the goal is to manage suffering. Our goal is to take on the mindset in which there's no suffering and abide in that. No suffering at all. Ramana Maharshi didn't suffer. Sri Sri Anandamayi did not suffer at all. People argue whether Jesus suffered or not. I say he did not at all, actually. Longchenpa, same thing. Did not really suffer at all. True mind, natural mind, doesn't suffer at all. It's incapable of suffering, actually. Totally incapable of it. Now the world will say, well, no, you need to be able to relate to suffering. You're here to help. Well, let me tell you something. Suffering is merely, an option. We can imagine that suffering's possible. But none of it is true. Nothing actually can suffer. It's impossible. So on a whim, we can have an exercise, an option. I'm going to believe in suffering, but it's not mandatory at all. And what happens, this world says, well, you know, you need to suffer because this helps the world out. The world, you know, your world's trying to manufacture a self, you know, and if you don't go along with and help it out, help it grow a self, it's going to suffer. It's going to be sad. But wait a minute. If all suffering is optional, entirely optional, that includes the world's suffering too, doesn't it? Think about this. It includes the world's suffering. So the idea that somehow you have to suffer because someone else, you have to choose the option of suffering because something else has no choice but to suffer, and therefore you have to help them out, otherwise they're going to suffer, is a lie. And that's one of the most devious lies of all. The idea, well, you have to be here to help the world out, otherwise the world's going to suffer. No, all suffering is optional. My suffering, your suffering, the world's suffering, the universe suffering is completely make-believe, dream, optional. Natural mind cannot suffer. Natural mind cannot suffer. We can only imagine another mind and imagine that it's suffering. That's all we can do. It's just a silly dream. Same with the world, same with everything. Now, we want to get an abidance here with the non-suffering mind. Not to glimpse it and then go back to suffering. Say, oh, okay, I had a peak experience. Now I'm going to go help the world suffer, you know. Help the world relate to suffering. We need to atone for something, sacrifice something. There was a street preacher today I saw. I haven't seen him in 15 years. And suddenly he's there. And the church says, God died for your sins, you know. God died for your sins and suffered so that you could be free of your sins, you know. In other words, the idea that some massive suffering is required to pay the price of suffering so that we don't have to suffer is saying that suffering is necessary. There's no such thing as necessary suffering. It's just something we can imagine as a whim, like, well, we want an option of believing this possible, but it's not really possible, not at all. So this is the core. And so working on abidance is what's called core work, spiritual core work. Now, most of us are loath to do that. Say, I use the analogy of exercise. I exercised for like maybe 6 months before I did any ab work. I said, no, it's too painful. I'm not going to do it. I try to avoid it as long as possible. And at some point, finally, I actually tried to do a little some. It was like, whoa, my God, I'm so sore the next day. It was terrible. I said, oh, this is awful. But something in me said, well, I don't really have anything else to try, and I'm not really in good enough shape, so I might as well try that. So somehow I started doing some ab work, core work, and I've kept doing it now. I've been doing it maybe about close to a month, you might say. And what a difference that has made. Wow. And so I'm getting after it. Did a lot today, already. Tonight I'll do some more. I'm trying to do it like twice a day, and all day I'm trying to do core work, which is different than trying to build your arm, upper bodies, your chest, your shoulder, build that up, or your legs, running and stuff. Now core work is quite different. You really can't do core work unless you actually specialize and actually do it. It's interesting, isn't it? And initially painful. It's not the most, pleasant exercise, because you could feel, ah, oh, it's really just a strain on my. But what a big difference it makes. Same thing with spiritual core work. You have to do the core work to get to abidance. And this is what we've been trying to do. And nobody's really wanting to do it. That's understandable, but it's regrettable. And it doesn't work. If you don't do it, it doesn't work. So hopefully at some point, more and more people will start to get into the spiritual core work, which is what I am emphasizing and recommending here. Reality is unscripted. It has no script. And abiding with the intensity of the wow of that. The wow is core work. Full stop in the war in the wow is core work. You could feel the burn. Just like when you do core abs work, core work, you feel the burn. Well, you could feel the burn when we do these spiritual practices of full stop in the wow. And again, the serious people will do the core work. And the superficial will not. They'll go for some, they'll be chipping and putting and making themselves look good. So you can cover up a multitude of errors by working on your short game. But you're just deceiving yourself. You're just deceiving yourself. And I know, I've been there. And you think, gee, I may just spend, every day hours on the putting green. I'm just going to be such a great putter. Well, so what? So you're great at like rolling a little ball. I mean, is that really golf? No, not really. So what if you could chip well? Is that really golf? No. Someone in a wheelchair can do that. Okay? Yeah, someone in a wheelchair can learn to putt well and chip well. Some weakling could do that just fine, no problem. See? But get up there and be able to, just have great form and rip a drive, 300. And do that all day long, on the course, and just have the right swing, mechanics, and know have the strength, and just drive your ball, through the golf course, and this is golf. It is not about scoring, okay. Sure, the pros have to score well, but they do everything else well, but if you want to do it right, it's about the capacity. It's about the capacity to overpower that golf course, and you can't do that unless you have a strong core. You cannot. And this is what I've discovered through. It's ridiculous. After like 40 years of practicing, I'd never really practiced core with golf. Never did I. I just resisted it, and so I think we're all in the same boat. We resist core work for some bizarre reason, and yet we do. So just keep that in mind, and at some point you will get into spiritual core work. Full stop in the wow is spiritual core work. That's what we do here. Most, won't do it, right? They want to be out there, scoring good. They want to seem spiritual. We're sitting here just quiet, feeling the burn. that spiritual core work. This leads to abidance, real abidance, genuine abidance in non-suffering. The non-suffering mindset, which is the natural mindset. It's really the only mindset there is that is real. So I keep finding exercises now, like, wow. You know, I say, oh, okay, so this is how you're supposed to swing. This is the muscles you're supposed, these are the muscles you're supposed to use. Oh my gosh, I'm so sore. You know, it's like, ah, oh, it's weak there. I can't. And so I figure out exercises to you know, keep working on those muscles and the move that you need to make. It's the back and the hips and how they pull and they pull through, and then you sort of like you corkscrew yourself and then you uncorkscrew yourself, and when you do it that way, it's so smooth and beautiful. The swing is so smooth and beautiful and effortless. Like, wow, that's how it's done. But you have to be really powerful in your core to do it this way. And some people have naturally really strong cores, okay, so golfers and they could do it, but most of us don't. We really have to work at it. So I see the work that needs to be done. Very interesting. So I'm not out there chipping and putting. I stopped doing that a long time ago. I don't even go to a driving range now. What's the use? You're just fooling yourself. If your core isn't strong, then forget about it. You know, you're just trying to find a way to fake it. That's right. Just trying to find a way to fake it. Can I fake my way around the golf course? And that's what most golfers do. Scrambling, 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 scrambling. Really, the goal is to just be able to play smooth and easy and untroubled and unfazed by it all, because you have what it takes. You have what it takes, plain and simple. You either have what it takes or you don't. And if you don't, you have to fake it. So, you know, we're out there practicing all this short stuff so I can say, oh, at least I scored well. What'd you get? Oh, I saved a par on that hole. I got a bogey or something. But in the round, you say, whew, you know, wow, I wasn't exposed too badly as a faker out there. But in the back of our minds, we know that we don't get it. I just don't get it. I just don't get it. I don't quite feel like I belong out here. That's the mindset of almost all golfers. And it's the same mindset as almost all of those who look at spirituality in some regard. They say, they just say, I just don't get it. I feel like a faker, right? But when you start doing this core work, full stop on the wow, you realize you're legit. You're actually paying attention to what's legit, what legitimizes you. Had a dream last night. Very positive. There was this cat. And I saw the cat. I was coming home to home, and there was this cat there. And I said, "Oh my gosh, I haven't seen you for so long. Ah, so great to see you. How have you been?" You know, and the cat was just so blissfully welcomed me. Oh my God, the cat was so blessed to see me. The cat was in bliss anyway, but you could tell it was just absolutely thrilled to see me. What a welcoming I got. And the cat, oh, it just, you know, just was just, wouldn't stop. It was so happy. Just like, wow, I remember you. You know, do you think, I wondered maybe he has forgotten me. I thought that maybe the cat has forgotten me. Not at all. Not at all. This was quite a shock. I said, it's been so long. Does the cat even remember me? Oh, the cat absolutely remembered me. It was just overjoyed to see me. Interesting dream, huh? Is that, what is the cat? What does it stand for? We used to use the term cat, hipster language. It means, you know, is a cool person. Say, that's a cool cat, or a person. That's a real cool cat. Or, you know, it could refer to what? The self. It could be the self. The true self that's in bliss, naturally in bliss. And I'm wondering, hey, I've been dreaming for so long. When I wake up, will the self recognize itself? Right? Will I recognize myself? Yes. Yes. And the cat was all like a puffball almost, you know. It just is just fur in all directions, like a puffball, sort of. This beautiful, wonderful puffball of a cat that was just extremely blissful, naturally blissful. So what a nice welcoming that was. What a great dream that was. It's been quite some time since I've had good dreams. It is really weird. I cannot make heads or tails of the sequencing of dreams, because there was a time, well, it might have been last summer or maybe last spring, almost a year ago or so. But for a couple of months, every night I had these dreams where I was enlightened, you know, just like the dreams were just blissful, and I thought, wow, this is it. I'm going to wake up, and then they disappeared, haven't come back. I have no idea why. Isn't that just extraordinary? Maybe I got away from doing the core practices. Maybe I got worried, or I don't know, or just nobody was really interested. I say, well, no one's interested. If you get up and say, hey, everybody, okay, we're gonna work on our abs. Who goes? All right, that's great. Well, not many, right? They say, I'd rather take a jog. I'd rather walk, or I'd rather do this or that. Yeah, it's still that way, but I'm getting more and more into it because I'm feeling the difference. I talked to somebody, a golfer. Yeah, he said when he was young, he injured his back because his core wasn't strong, and the doctor told him you have to work, strengthen your core. So he said every day since then, he has worked on his core. Every day he does all these sit-ups every single day, and so no, somebody, yeah, two people. Another person told me that too. I meet these people who said, he says he works on his core every day because of a back problem I used to have. And he says, I never had back problems since. It just, you know, but I have to keep doing it. You have to have the discipline to do the core work. So I'm getting these people telling me this, reinforcing this. And indeed, my neck went out because I was doing too much upper body work, trying to strengthen my shoulders and arms, trying to look beefy up here. But it tightened everything up and pulled my neck out real bad. So I've stopped doing that, and I'm now focusing just on the core. Okay, the core of your body. The hips and the abdomen, you know, the upper thighs and all that strength there. This is where we get the ultimate agility. And I find like my posture is just amazing now. I can't help but like just stand up. I feel like I'm a foot taller. You know, I'm walking. I'm just naturally, my whole posture is so good. I'm just like, I feel like I'm floating almost. Instead of someone who just slumped over like this and no core strength. Wow. And it just, I keep on, you know, just keep on working on this and just keep strengthening it. I still have some pains there. I have some sort of trouble with swinging a golf club. It gets a little painful here, but you know, I'm able to kind of wears off sooner than before. So it's the way to go. It's the way to go, and yet it takes a great resolve to do it. But once you get through the initial soreness and trouble, then it gets a lot easier, and it's like I look forward to it. I say, oh yeah, great, I get the strength of my core, and the benefits that come are tremendous. Now with golf, the benefits is just you feel legit out there, you know. It's just wow, what a different feeling. I'm looking forward to this. I don't care what my score is, you know. That doesn't reflect upon my core strength or you know, ability to hit the ball the right way or swing, have a great swing. I got a great swing. If you have a great swing, you know, you feel legitimate. And so it really takes pressure off. It's, I don't, so what? I don't care how I score. I know I can do this. I play every day. I feel powerful. I feel strong. I'm doing it right. You know, it's fine. Whereas if you don't have that, you're all stressed out about, you know, I got to make a good score. I got to make a good score. I got to make a good score. I got to try to legitimize myself through my score. And it's, you know, that's a real pain. It really is. Same thing with spirituality. If we're not in abidance, we think, well, I got to be real spiritual. I got to be real metaphysical. I got to be real esoteric. I got to learn all this stuff, complexities. I got to master all the complexities and all this stuff. And you're struggling, struggling, struggling. But if you do full stop in the wow, you don't struggle like that. I'm not worried about any of that stuff. Boy, do we procrastinate. Me too. Isn't it amazing? I procrastinated doing spiritual core work for like 35 years or so. Really? Or more than that. Maybe 40 years or something. I procrastinated. No, I don't need to do that. No, I don't need to do that. And finally, I started doing it, and it's made all the difference in the world. I feel spiritually strong, like a good spiritual posture, you might say. I have a good, really good spiritual posture, getting better all the time. And so I'm doing my stretching, physical stretching. I know now kind of what to stretch. You need to stretch this, do the core work and stretch. Core work and flexibility. That's what really is important. We don't need to get all muscle bound. That actually hurts us. If you get upper body, you're too muscle bound, that slows things down. It's more like flexibility. Relax and be flexible. And be quick. You've seen some golfers that tried to bulk up upper body and they ruined their career. Because what they had was real strong core and then the rest of the body was just very quick and flexible. And they got too muscle bound and slowed them down, messed them up. They get injured and their careers are never the same actually. So we're not interested in metaphysics, esotericism, spirituality, all that kind of stuff. We're just interested in the non-dual core truths and the core practice actually here. Just interested in practicing the core exercises here. That's it. And the rest will take care of itself. That is for sure. And I've been practicing this new swing, and it's like, wow, yeah, that's a beauty. I mean, that is just a beauty. That's the way it's supposed to be done. Holy cow. I never did it like this before. And so the temptation is, you know, let me go work on my short game. And no. Hey, you know, if you play every day your short game, you're going to dial it in pretty quickly. And it'll be there. It's easy once you play. If you play every day, you get the feel and the touch. It's all touch, really. But the core game is not touch. Okay, the core game is you really have to work out and be strong. That's not something you can get just through touch. But if you're not strong, how can you play every day? You're going to get sore. You're going to get injured. All that kind of stuff. So first, work on the core. Same with the spiritual. Work on the core. The other stuff, yeah, it's just all touch, you know, and you'll get it easily. I've been doing jump rope again. My knee hurts a little bit. I'm a little concerned about that. I got some issue there. But hammering the jump rope, that helps the core, that is for sure. Lightening up. I gained 0.5 pound yesterday. I starved myself and gained 0.5 pound. How do you figure that? Pretty disappointing. I was amazed. But that's how it goes. So again, don't be discouraged if you don't do the core work. Just keep doing what you're doing. And at some point, you'll say, oh, that really doesn't quite work for me. And then you'll start doing the core work. And once you start doing it, you'll say, oh, that's wonderful. I'm not going to get away from that. No way. That's where it's at, actually. Now, it's really interesting how I started doing core work. Physical exercise is, I just refused to do sit-ups or crunches. I said, that's so painful, so awkward, you know. I just won't do it, but I have this foam roller. It's about like 6 inches in diameter or so. And I just roll my back on that to help you loosen up my back muscles and keep the back aligned. And I found that if I kind of move the roller with my arms like this, it puts tremendous stress on my core, tremendous stress. And if I just do that a lot, wow, does it give an incredible core workout. Fabulous. And I don't have to do all these crunches or sit-ups at all. It's just kind of roll on the roller, and it puts tremendous stress on the core. Really great. And so it's easy. So I said, wow, I found an easy way to work on the core without trying to do, you know, sit-ups, which are so awkward. I don't like them. You have to like, or crunches. You have to anchor yourself somehow. It's just, I don't know. Young people like doing them. I used to do it when I was young a lot. I was very good at that. I set a bunch of records in school for how fast I could do, like, incredibly fast. And, you know, in a certain time limit, I was able to do a massive amount. So I was really into it then. But now I'm not into it. I don't want to do it. So this is another way to not only stretch all your muscles and do flexibility, but also do core work at the same time. So I'm really blessed to be able to do that. And also the stretch bands, the Pilates rubber stretch bands, the rubber bands that stretch, rubber tubes. I've been able to do exercises there that also, I feel it now, get a really work on my core. So, very helpful. And what do? You just keep doing it. You just keep doing it. It doesn't happen, you know, overnight. You know, gradually become stronger. Gradually become stronger. Gradually become stronger. Good core, good knees. But certainly the core is just essential. Same with spiritual practice. The core is essential. You're going to find that you're going to need it going forward. You're going to need core strength to full stop in the wow. You have to be able to do that. Because you have to keep flipping the script on the world, right? If you don't flip the script the world is giving you, you're going to be pulled into that script. It's one or the other, right? Because their script is so strong and so insistent. If you don't flip it, you'll be pulled into it. They say, no, well, you could have some compromise. No, but their pull is so strong. It's like a super strong magnet. You're going to be pulled into that if you don't reverse polarity, flip the script on the magnet, and no attraction to it. Suddenly, all attraction is gone. So you have to be able to flip the script going forward. And when you flip the script, you're going to get this wow reaction for sure. And so then you have to practice full stop on the wow. So this is just, you know, ABC. 1, 2, 3. Got to do it. This is why I've been emphasizing it for years now and telling people, look, you got to get into this. It's not too late to get into it. It's not too late. But those who don't, I can't, you know, say anything about it, really. I mean, you'll be attracted into the scripts of the world or try fashion some compromise, which will just make you feel very unstable. That's very bad. You know, don't try to go in two directions at the same time. You're going to get mental chaos, mental illness. You're going to fall apart. So whatever you do, have faith in flipping the script. Even if you don't struggle with a compromise, keep saying, the Holy Spirit will help me flip this script. Well, flip the script. It's a total thing, right? You flip it upside down and you turn the tables. Completely turn the tables is the only way to deal with these extremely arrogant and overconfident mindset that's in the world that has done a hostile takeover of this world, is you have to flip the script on them. There's no alternative. They are all in with their overconfidence. They say, we have a way to manage suffering where you won't even need to worry about being free of suffering, which is our intrinsic mind. So don't even worry about that. We'll teach you how to manage your suffering so well. Managing your suffering, right? Well, painkillers, for instance, surgeries and painkillers and all these advanced modes of killing the pain. They say, well, we're managing our pain so much better now, aren't we? As if that's, you know, should satisfy you. It doesn't satisfy us. But they're super confident, overconfident. The plague of this world is overconfidence in managing suffering. There's a plague. It's a mental plague. It's the worst plague in history, this overconfidence. And they say, don't worry. They're making every effort to make it beautiful and attractive and soft and benign and comfortable. And they're marketing it that way, right, with a velvet glove. It's a very, very mistaken path the world is on. And yet they're trying to ease our concerns by this, you know, by marketing it in a feminine way to make it seem soft and vulnerable and beautiful and nice and motherish and, you know, don't worry, you know, it's like we're infantizing us and say, don't worry, mother will soothe your pain. You know, she has ways to soothe your pain. What is mother but a painkiller, you know, right? And so as they're marketing this pain-killing, managing your suffering ideology, mother is the way it's being marketed. Women, mother, the way it's being marketed. It's just a fact. And that soothes our concerns, that we're crying, oh, I don't know, I'm so much pain. Don't worry, mother's always there with mother's little helper. You know, we don't worry, we got a pill for everything. We have some modality for everything. We'll hook you up, you know, we can do brainwave, you know, modification, blah, blah, on and on and on and on. Genetic engineering will engineer you somehow. So you have resistance, inoculations will shoot you up with 100 different vaccinations. You know, instead of accepting natural mind, which is intrinsically free of any and all suffering, intrinsically so without doing anything. It is inherently so. In fact, it's impossible for natural mind to suffer in any way. Impossible. Cannot be sick. Cannot suffer. And that's what we are. So instead of helping us awaken from this nightmare to what we are, we're saying, no, 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 no. You can keep dreaming. The world says, you can keep dreaming. Don't worry. Yeah, there's suffering. This dream is suffering. But we can manage the suffering so well that you'll be fine. You'll be fine. Mother will take care of you. Don't worry. So you see how it is here. You see how it is. And hopefully this is motivating some of you to start doing some of this core work, full stop in the wow. Wow, because you have to flip the script. You have to flip the script. And get good at that. Keep doing it. Keep flipping the script. And keep laughing. As you flip the script, you'll have great humor. Like, wow. Yeah. I feel great. I know I'm going to no suffering at all without even... I don't have to manage my suffering because I won't suffer at all. And, you know, the world wants everyone to relate to suffering. It's like, well, you gotta be able to relate to suffering because some are just intrinsically have to suffer. The world is suffering. You know, no one has to suffer. And suffering is not intrinsic at all to reality. So you're never going to get free of suffering by simply relating with others that are suffering. Never. Never, never. The only way is to relate to non-suffering. And get comfortable and get used to non-suffering. So we need the saints in the world, those who are not suffering, so we can start relating to that and get comfortable with it. That's the only way. And we're trying to ban that from our psyche. It's like some kind of myth. You know, that this. So May through November of the 2016 is going to be the time where this overconfidence simply becomes overbearing and the world tilts in that direction so much that it will seem as though what we're talking about here is just a myth. It's a form of mental illness is what they'll eventually come up with. And they say, don't worry, that's treatable too. That's a form of suffering, and we can treat that. The idea that you can be free of suffering is a vain hope, they will say, and you're going to be this great suffering from realizing it's a vain hope. So we're able to treat that suffering too. So there's a tipping point is coming July 24th, 2016, a tipping point. Some sort of tipping point is going to happen. It's going to start in May. It's going to start in May, accelerate in June, and then hit its peak in July 24th, 2016, and from there all bets are off. Okay, I'm not going to extrapolate further, but it's just all bets are off as far as this world is concerned. Yeah, huge wind suddenly came up when I said that. Isn't that interesting? Wow, cool. How was that? How apropos was that? Synchronicity. A sudden severe bluster just whoosh. So just after I said, all bets are off, what's going to happen? It's going to get very windy, very blustery. Turmoil, severe turmoil. So we wanted to have the core work done. We want to have the core work. We want to be strong in our core, our spiritual core, before May 27th, for instance. Let's put that as a date before May 27th. We want to be strong in our spiritual core before May 27th. Now, I don't feel strong enough. I feel I could do a lot more, a lot more. Now, I've seen the Holy Spirit has shown me that I'm strong enough, but I'm not going to rest on my laurels. Don't ever rest on your laurels given the situation. Yeah, I want to pick up the pace and work, 10 times as hard, actually. And I may do that, actually. I may very well do that for like a one-month intensive here. This is something that's on my mind, starting to come up. What about doing 1 month intensive? 1 month intensive here. What do you think about that? Who's up for that? Who's up for that? April 27th through May 27th, a one-month intensive where we intensively work on our core, full stop on the wow, the core work. And then we take our chances from there, right? I mean, if you were to do like ab work, core work physically for like 1 month starting on the 27th, you know what? In 1 month's time, you would be pretty doggone strong. You know that? You would. It would be fundamentally different than you used to be. Just 1 month. I've been doing it about a month. And I'm fundamentally different. My whole swing changed on golf swing. I realized there's a new way to swing, a better way to swing, and I have the strength to do it in 1 month. So a one-month intensive, this is on my mind. We'll see how that comes about. I may very well do that. But I'm pouring out more and more videos, and this is getting you ready for an intensive, isn't it? Because after May 27th, basically all bets are off. I mean, after the 24th of July for sure, but after May 27th, you better have some core strength, or else the wheels are going to start coming off. So by all means, stick with this and just suffer, but it should be enjoyable. Like, wow, I'm gaining spiritual core strength. There's nothing better in this world than to do the spiritual exercise that gets your core of abidance, that strengthen your capacity for abidance. This is what we're after, is abidance. We're not after spirituality. We're after abidance in our true nature. We're not after esotericism. We're after abidance in our true nature. Like Ramana Maharshi, we're after that. We're after that. Nothing less than that. Nothing less than that. Now, our style might seem a little different, superficially, okay? But no, we're after abidance. Thank you, Ramana Maharshi, for showing us the goal and not lowering the bar so we could relate with the goal, so we could start relating to the goal. If you don't have a goal, how can you start relating with it? You see how dangerous it is? The what we're going into in this world is we want to lower the bar down and say, well, everybody's good. We're all managing our suffering, getting better and better, and that's it. And we avoid the bar of inherent freedom from any suffering. We say it doesn't exist. It's a myth. It's mental illness. This is the extreme danger that this society is leading us into. Extreme plague. So, Ram Maharshi came in, he set the bar where it needs to be set. All praise to the great, to the Dharma King, Ram Maharshi, great is redundant. All praise to the Dharma King, Ramana Maharshi, who set the bar where it needs to be set. And so gave us an opportunity to start working out on our core and say, wow, what do I need to do to get there? What do I need to do to get that mindset that Ramana had? And so we start working on it. Wow. So we just give a moment of gratitude here. It's absolutely justified. See, that's a wow right there. That's core practice right there. Gratitude to the Dharma Kings and Queens. Pure gratitude. If you can feel that, that's great core work right there. Just stop for a moment and allow yourself to feel that. That is so important. Be able to slow down. When you feel this gratitude, you don't feel like doing anything else. So you're able to slow down. There's gratitude. It's not easy. The mind keeps trying to interfere. So that's too high. The bar's too high. It's not fair. It's not fair. No, it's absolutely fair. There's nothing standing in our way except our own steady discipline and determination. That's all that's required. Is to stop trying to purchase our freedom from non-suffering. We're trying to get free of non-suffering. How stupid is that? It's whimsical, you know, at best. Isn't it? Okay. All praise, you know, all praise and gratitude to those who set the bar where it needs to be set. They have been invaluable to us, invaluable. And we call upon them to help us in our hour of utmost need and urgency here, to motivate our practicing the way it should be, to elevate our practicing. What else can we ask for than to elevate our practicing, so the core becomes so strong and we're able to handle abundance. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.